technical evangelist for Amazon Web Services. And as a technical evangelist, I talk with a lot of people, mostly developers, to get the feedback, what we can do as Amazon Web Services to help them build better products in an easier way. And also, I try to help them use our services, because sometimes it makes it easier to build an application than to start from scratch. Today, I'd like to talk about machine learning. I think it's an interesting topic, because it's not an easy one. And my focus would be to talk about machine learning for developers. So is there any machine learning PhD in the room now? No? Good, because they would be probably completely bored, because we will not talk about the internal algorithms that you can use, but we will talk how you can use them in building an application. So this is the web page from Amazon.com in 1994, the year Amazon was incorporated. And as you can see, probably the graphics is not in line with the current standards. But just to show you how machine learning is important for us, you can see that in this very first version, there was a reference to an internal service that was called Eyes, so Meet Eyes, that was suggesting you the book that you can be interested with. So from the very beginning, we were like this. And of course, things have evolved over time. We use machine learning internally a lot to help our customer find what is interesting for them. And we use it also internally to improve our own process. For example, in our warehouses, we use machine learning together with robots to optimize the layout of the data center, reduce the possibility of errors, and speed up the delivery of the packages. So when we talk about data analytics, there are really three kinds of focus that you can have. First, there is a retrospective way of looking at your data. So you want to analyze what happened and build maybe reports and dive deep into numbers to understand what happened. Then there is the current status of your data, the here and now. So you will probably need some streaming service that brings real-time data to a dashboard where someone, maybe the top management, maybe the people in charge of some aspects of your company, can really look in real time to what is happening to sales, to delivery, to customer service, to important numbers of your company. And then there is the possibility to look to the future, build predictions, learning from what happened in the past and is happening now, to enable a different kind of application, what we call smart application, because they can really use the prediction to improve themselves. So machine learning by itself, this is one of the definitions, is the technology that allows you to find patterns, and to find these patterns in your data automatically, without you knowing in advance what is happening. And then using these patterns, you can build a model, and using the model, you can make predictions. So your data with machine learning is what I would call a smart application. So there are here a few examples that maybe can help understand what you can build with machine learning in your application. So if you are, like Amazon, someone that is selling a product or a service, and you have users, to know if the users are interested or not in your service can be helpful. And we will see a live demo for a banking scenario during the presentation. Or if you are selling something, you want to know if this order that someone is doing online, you don't have any direct contact with this customer, is a right order or is a fraud. Because online, you know, there's a lot of people that can connect just to find a fraud and fraud your service. So this is another way where machine learning can help and find patterns into frauds. And for example, if you read the news online, having some tool that suggests you what are the other news that can be related to the one that you are reading and that can be interesting for you. There are a lot of other possible use cases that you can put into your application. Customer support. Every company, especially startups, they have a limited capacity to directly touch their users with an email or with a phone call. So having the possibility to classify all the interaction and understand which one are more actionable, which one you should invest time of the people, and which one the customer support can maybe manage more easily, it's important. And marketing, of course, is another choice. So what is the problem? Why we don't see a lot of machine learning-enabled applications? Because machine learning expertise is rare. You usually need a data scientist, someone with the PhD in machine learning that I mentioned. And then, even if you have this guy that knows everything about algorithms, when you put these algorithms into an implementation, you need to scale this implementation. And this is not the skill of a data scientist, it's the skill of a computer scientist. So you need to merge these skills and build a platform that is scalable, that can run in production, can be fast enough to give maybe real-time prediction for your application. And closing this gap, it's not easy. It's not easy. And we learn it by ourselves. So to make it things worse, let's look a little bit back in time. In the year 2001, Amazon, they didn't discover the monolith on the moon, like in the movie, but we discovered the monolith inside our IT. It was our own applications. We realized, as a lot of other companies, that we were spending more time managing the internals of our application, managing all the complexity of the monolithic application, than to deliver features to our customers. So what we did, we decided to work with a lot of things, but the most important thing was to work with small teams. So we decided that big teams, they cannot work, they cannot scale together with the company, so we created this two-pizza rule. So we said, and these are American pizza, so big ones. I'm from Italy, so if with two pizza, you can eat two people, so it would be not enough. But two pizza teams. So if the team is too big that it cannot be fed by two pizza, then probably it's too big also to manage a project. You should split the project, find the correct boundary, the current context where to split the project in two, and let the two projects grow afterwards. And this was 2001, 2002, and it's of course, reminds a lot of microservices that we probably you heard of already today. And we also put this team in charge of all the development cycle of the application up to production. So this small team, to give a number, maybe 7 is the number of people that we look for a project. They are in charge of the development of the application and of automating the test and the deployment, because with cloud computing, everything is programmable, so it doesn't make sense to have someone else to manage the deployment in production of your application. You can develop your application and how to deploy it. And actually, cloud computing was born for AWS out of this context, because these small teams, they require to have a lot of power, good tools to work and build their own applications. So they didn't like the tooling that was available back in the time. So they needed concepts like an internal virtual machine service that was self-service and then you would pay only by the use, an internal storage service that with a web interface you can use and use for building the storage of your application. And from these ideas, we created internal services that later on became the AWS that that maybe you already know, that I know, like Amazon EC2, Amazon S3. And we did the same also for machine learning. So we couldn't scale all these small teams having one of the 7 people to be a data scientist, because it just won't scale. So we created an internal service that we used for years in Amazon that was easy to use for developers with a standard API interface that developers can plug in, put their data, get their own predictions. And this was the way we currently use machine learning in Amazon. And this year, we decided to make it available for everybody. So we created a service, Amazon Machine Learning Service. And this service is available for anyone to use with a very reasonable price. I will tell the price towards the end. But I think this is what I would call an open service, because it's open because anybody can use it and affordable enough to use it into your own projects. And I will talk about cost, because cost is one of the main characteristics of cloud computing. So sometimes people think cloud computing is just a technology, but it's also a business model. So if you don't talk about cost, if I say, OK, this is available for everyone to use, just give me 100K per month and you're free to use, probably the room would be empty and maybe just a few people will remain. So this is user for developers, because you can really use everything from the web console or everything through an SDK. We provide SDK for multiple languages. I will give examples using Python today, maybe because Python is the first language you have in mind when you think of machine learning. But the same you can do with .NET, JavaScript, and the client or the server side, Ruby, Java. And you can also directly access this machine learning service from a mobile application in iOS or Android to do real-time predictions that you can use within your application to optimize dynamically the content that you provide for your users. So this is based on years of technology. So it's not something that we created and put outside. It's the internal service that we grow up for years. So it's not just the algorithms that we use, it's also how the overall workflow works from a developer perspective, so that it can plug in inside a project that is already working. And it can grow with your needs. So you can start very small to do, and it's also very cheap. And then you can grow and in the quantity of data, in the number of predictions that you want to build. The prediction can be built in batch. So you provide a file, and we give you a batch prediction based on that file, or real time with a real time interface. You can use data that is stored in other AWS services. So we have a storage services, Amazon S3 is an object storage. This is the most obvious way to use this service and build prediction on this data. But we also, you can also use data on other databases like MySQL database or a Redshift database that is an analytical database. And we also use our identity and access management to tailor the security of the access to the service so that this allows, for example, to use the service from a mobile application. So a mobile application that you give to end users can be safely authenticated with the service using some of our technology without putting credentials inside a mobile application. It's quite cool. It's a completely managed service, so you don't need to see the virtual machine, patch the operating system, tune anything. You just need to use it, but we will see that there's still a lot of craftsmanship that is required to use this kind of services. So these are the three phases. You have to build a model. This is the first step of machine learning, build a model on top of your data that will find the patterns. Then you can evaluate and optimize the model, and then you can start using the predictions. So here, the first step is to create a data source. A data source is where your data is. And from this data source, you can explore and understand your data. We will see that live. So it's very important because we will see that it's very important that you, for a machine learning model to be built very well, to understand your data and enrich your data before building the model. I will give you a few examples of that. So to create a data source, you just go on the console, analyze your data. I go fast here because we will see a live demo. The network is working very well, so I'm not spending time here. I would like to give you the example. So everything that we will do through the web console, you can do it programmatically. This is the example in Python. So we have SDKs for multiple languages. This is Boto, is our SDK for Python. So you create a connection to the machine learning service. You create a data source saying where the file is stored on S3. And where the schema of the data is or will be saved, and everything is managed automatically. Then you can explore and look at your data. So see how the data is, for example, if you have a 0-1 value, a flag inside your data, you want to understand how it's distributed. What is the correlation of all the variables that you give us with the target variable that you want to predict? This is a very important information. How the variables are distributed. Which kind of variable we are using, and the distribution. So this is an important aspect. In the demo, I will not have time to spend a lot of efforts on this, but you have to learn your data. And then you can train your model. You can use the default configuration, or you can tailor it. You can start with the default, because it's our expertise that we put in, and then you can customize. And then of course, you can also use a programmatic approach. So in Python, you can build a model from a data source that you created with just one line of code. Here you see the model type. So Amazon Machine Learning is doing what is called supervised learning. So with machine learning, there are two kinds of environment. With unsupervised learning, you give data without any past data, and you build out some analytics, like clustering, splitting your customer in groups that have similar pattern. We don't do that. We do supervised learning. Supervised learning means that you give us old data, let's say data that has already the variable inside, so what happened in the past, and we build a model on top of that that can build prediction. And we can do three kinds of predictions. We can do binary classification, so on a variable that tells you true or false, 0 or 1. We can do multi-class classification. It means that you have, for example, a set of customer or a set of emails, and you want to classify them. Maybe usually spamming is a binary classification. This email is spam or is not spam. But you can also build a multi-class classification. So this email is spam, a normal email, or a very important email that I want to get more attention. And you can build a multi-class classification service. And we can also do regression. So regression is to estimate a real variable, like the temperature of the weather or something like that. And then you can explore from the model the quality of your data. This is a very important tool. For example, for binary classification, usually in machine learning, you look at the area under the curve. It's what is called these graphics. And then you can tailor, because depending on the use case that you do, machine learning algorithms will always have some kind of errors. This can be false true positive, false positive, or false negatives. And depending on your use case, you have to tailor if you want to have more false positive or more false false negative. Sorry. Let's make an example. Let's do the spamming example of the email. You want to classify an email as spam or not spam. If you receive a lot of spam and you are OK to lose a few good emails, then you can say, OK, even if some email is classified as spam, and maybe it's OK because I receive so many emails that I really don't want to have spam slow down all my people who is working inside my company. On the other side, maybe this is your order email address where customers are sending their orders. So you don't want to lose any order from your customers. So it's better to have a few spamming emails that are not recognized and will reach the users than losing an order from a customer. So tailoring here in these graphics, the false positive or the false negative, and the behavior of the classification, it's something that depends on the actual use case you are implementing. I'll go fast here. So batch prediction are, as I said, you give a file, and then we will build a batch prediction. We will see an example. And you can, of course, do the same via your own favorite SDK. When you have a model, you can give a file, and we will build the batch prediction. And that batch prediction will estimate the variable that you want to learn. Let's say that this 0 and 1 are 0. This is a normal email. 1 is a spamming email. And we will classify that and give you a score of the classification. And we also provide real time. With real time, you can integrate the classification with your application. For example, you can, I don't know, if you have options that your user are using, you can try to understand from the behavior of other users which are the options that this user will use. So maybe you have a map, and you have a lot of input from your user. So the user is in this location, is using the application in this way. So probably I should pre-configure the map in this way so that the user has not to do everything by itself. And you know that the first time a user is using an application is very important to give a good impression. Because with mobile application, for example, a lot of the users, they download it, use it. If they don't like it, they remove it immediately or stop using it. So preparing the environment for new users based on all the past behavior of other users can be a really good weapon for your application. So you can, for prediction, you have an API call. You can put it also on Android or iOS, so from a mobile application. You ask for a specific data point, which is the prediction, and we'll give you the estimation. So let's stop all this talking and see something live, because I think it gives much more an idea of how it works. So this is the console for Amazon Web Services. We have a lot of different tools. And here in the bottom, there are the one for analytics. So I select machine learning. So for machine learning, I have already something here, because we will not be able to do everything in real time. But let's start from scratch. So let's do this kind of scenario, where let's open this file here. You have some marketing activity. You are a bank. You have some product that you want to sell to your customer. And this is the past behavior of your customer. So you have a lot of information about your customer. Probably it's not easy to read it on the back, but it's nothing complex. So you have like the age, the job, the marital status, the education, the way you contacted the customer with a phone, with a cellular, the time of day you contacted the customer, a lot of information that you can collect. And at the end, you have a variable that tells you in the past. Sorry, I opened the file without the prediction. It's the same. And at the end, you have a variable that tells you 0 or 1. So the 0 means the user didn't buy the product. 1 means that the user actually bought the product. So this is a CSV file. And you can go here, and you can create a data source with input file and a model on top of this file. So I created a bucket. A bucket is how we categorize data on S3 for Dev Eternity. And here we have a data. And here I have the banking CSV file. So this is the Dev Eternity data. I verify that I can read this file correctly. The first column contains the name of the variables. So I have the age, the campaign, all the education, all the information that we saw previously. And we automatically understand if this is a number, this is a category, or this is a string or a text. And you can tailor if we make a mistake. But in this case, everything has been learned. And so now we understand the data. And then you have to give which is the target variable. So we have a lot of data. One of these variables is the one that you want to predict. So using all the other data, we will be able to predict the value of this variable. In this case, the variable that we want to predict is the last column. That is the one that is it's a binary. So we understood that it's a binary field. And it's 0 or 1, depending if the user bought or not the product. So I give OK here. The identifier, I skip it, but if you have a customer ID in this file, you can flag it so that we can use it when we do a prediction to give it back the prediction and the ID of the customer or the user that you want to predict on. I proceed, and now we created the data source, and now we can create a model. This is a binary model because the variable is binary, so it's binary classification. It can be multi-class or regression, as I said, for a real-time variable. I do the review, and now I created the model on top of the data source. And this will take some time. So if we go, for example, in the dashboard, and we filter by dev, you see that I created the data source. And the system automatically split the data in two groups. And this is very important for machine learning, because when you have data, you have to train data on a subset of your data, and then you have to evaluate the model on other data, not the same that you use to build the model. Otherwise, it's very easy that you have overfitting of data, because you always use the same data, so there is no capacity for the model to abstract to data outside the data set that you provide. So our service automatically will split the data in 70% of the data to build the model. And 30% will be used for the evaluation to test the model and see if on the new data the model works correctly or maybe completely behaves in a wrong way. And then after we split this data, we will build the model. And on the 30% that we splitted, we will do the evaluation. It takes usually for this data set 15 minutes, so I will skip it. And I already created the same a few days ago. So this is the same data that you saw, the same splitting, the model. So we can go on the model, for example. And here you see that the model has been configured. And you see this value here, the area under the curve, is the metric that you use for a machine learning algorithm to understand if it's working correctly or not. Zero, it's a value between 0 and 1. 0.5, it's a 50% chance. So for a binary classification means that you are not predicting anything because 50% chance is what you can build with a random implementation. If it's closer to 1, it means that it's a good value. In this case, it's very close to 1, it's 0.93. But let me say this is a fake value because this is a data that I prepared for this demo. Probably you will never get this close to predict anything with real data until you clean it a lot and work it a lot. But just to give you an idea, a value of 0.65, 0.7 is already very good. And here you can evaluate and adjust the score. So this is the classification, the area under the curve. The two colors here on the left and on the right, the one not the one with the bars, are the right classifications. The classification with the bars are the wrong, so false negative or false positive. And depending on your use case, now you have to make your own choice. So now we get on the evaluation, 91% data is evaluated correctly, but you get some errors, 9% is errors. It's not bad. It's very good for a machine learning algorithm. And you have 200 false positive and 800 false negative. So depending on your use case, it's more important to have false positive or false negative. And you can change it, moving the threshold between the two. For example, this is a preliminary medical examination. So depending on your census data, where you work, what you do, and everything, we evaluate if you should do some examination to see if you have some illness. Then it's much, much better that we do two more exams for someone than to say to someone, no, you're fine, don't do the examination. So this is the value of being able to balance false positive and false negative. And then you can give your data here, so you can build batch predictions. And if you give batch predictions, we do them, and we build a file like this. So you have a file that is exactly the same as the one with all the information of new customers, but you don't have at the end the 0-1 column because you don't know if this user are interested or not. So the same data, but the target variable will be in the batch file. And you can build a batch prediction, and the output will be something like this. So this is all the files are CSV, so I'm using Excel to open them, but you can use your favorite tool. To make it a little bit more readable, I'm changing the format of this cell to be a number with 4 digits after. So this is the prediction, 0 or 1. For example, this user has been predicted. And this is the actual value in the curve. So depending on where your threshold was, we use the classification to be 1 or not. And this is user 23. So if I go here and choose user 23 on the input file, I know that this user may be interested. So maybe I should call him at the phone or try to reach to him. So it's a way of working on the data. As I said before, if you have a customer ID or a product ID or something that is an ID inside this file, you can flag it, and we will add it here in the return value so that you have like an ID that you can use to look up in your database. So this is a way of building batch prediction. So you give the same variables, but the variable to predict, and we will do the work for you. Another important feature is real-time predictions. So we can try them. Real-time prediction works like batch, but with a single API call that takes milliseconds to execute when the model is built. So you can plug it into a web server, into a mobile application, and do real-time prediction to adjust the application to the behavior of your users. And in this case, you can put all the data here, or you can pass a record. So I will do that. So here I can, for example, this is the same file that I opened on Excel. I get all the data for this user, 31-year-old, divorced, professional, blah, blah, blah. I put the data here. I submit the data, and it's already populated. And then I can create the prediction. And in this case, I have a prediction of 0. So it's not interested. And the predicted score is actually very, very low. It's 0.00 something. So even if the threshold was moved towards the 0, this guy will never be interested into this product. So probably don't bother. And the same you can do using a real-time interface. So you go on the model. And here in the bottom, you can I already did it, actually. I enable real-time predictions. If you enable them, there is an additional hourly cost that is 0.1 cent of dollar, so 1/10 of a cent of dollar for every 10 megabytes of the data that you use. And and you get an endpoint that is where you will have to redirect your query for the real-time API. So you put this endpoint in your SDK, and our SDK will automatically do the rest. So I don't know. I think now it's a little bit clearer what we can do with the service, how it's very easy to use. And this can be used with a lot of different architectures. So I give you a few examples. Usually you want to build the good data set for your application. So what you can do, you can use a framework like Hadoop or Spark to analyze your data and build a condensed data set that will be given to the service. And then you can, so you aggregate, get your input data, it's raw data, you aggregate it and clean it, then you give to machine learning that can build prediction, and then you give your prediction to your application. Very, very easy. Next step, you can have a database that is the central repository of your information. Here I'm using Redshift, can be any database. There's no requirement that this database is on AWS. It can be something that you have on-premise or another cloud provider. And what you can do, you can get information and load the information to machine learning, maybe via S3 or directly, if you can. And then from the predictions that you build, you can bring back the prediction and load them on your application or your data, so that your data is augmented by the prediction, so that now you know all the users with flags that tell them if they are interested or not in some aspect of your application. Or you can have your mobile or web application that is querying the service in real time, as I said, to customize the user interface, maybe to the specific thing that you expect the user to do. You can also bind that to actions. I don't know if any one of you heard of AWS Lambda. It's a service that we released that allows you to load functions in the cloud, and you only pay for the hundreds of milliseconds of execution time of this function without having to manage operating system and everything. And every month, you get 400,000 seconds of free execution time with Lambda, so you can play a lot without having any cost, because 400,000 seconds is a lot. And for example, you can have, if a user is writing something on the database, you can trigger a Lambda function automatically that will maybe get some prediction based on the data that has been written and augment the data with the new prediction that you just built. This is something that you can build very easily. And within the execution framework that I said, you have very reduced cost. So where's the craftsmanship in all this discussion? Because I described you how you can use very easily a machine learning service in your application, possible use cases, where there's still a lot of to do. First of all, the title of my talk is Machine Learning for Developers, not for everyone, because you still need to understand the overall flow and how to manage the data. But managing the input data for a machine learning algorithm is very, very important. I give you an example. Let's say that we want to build a urban traffic model to predict the traffic in your own town or in different town. So you start collecting a lot of data points, maybe automatically using camera services or something, and that will tell you that in specific point of times, there is such number of cars with such average speed in a lot of different parts of your own town. So you collect a lot of these data points. And this is because date is probably affecting a lot the traffic in your town. But if you give a date to a computer, it's just a date. There is no more information than that. It has to understand a lot of more things. For example, is any difference in the traffic depending on the day of the week? Yeah, so which is the day that is the best probably for traffic? Let's say less traffic. Sunday probably, Thursday probably. And the worst day maybe for traffic, Friday. So you don't want to spend energy to make this information be extracted by a machine learning algorithm. A very complex algorithm can do that, but it's just a waste. So from the date, you should create a new field in the CSV file that is the day of the week, that maybe you decide is from 0 to 6 or to one, from 1 to 7, because otherwise the algorithm does not know this information and will have to spend a lot of computing power to extract this information. Sorry. Other information from the date. So all Thursdays or all Fridays are always worse, or there are some Fridays that are better? Holidays. If you don't put holidays, the algorithm will have to understand that this is an holiday. Some holidays like Easter, they always flow around. So probably another flag that tells you if this is an holiday. And yeah, of course, work holiday. Actually, this is something that you should learn. So, for example, should I put holiday to true on Sundays or not? This is really an open question because the algorithm of machine learning, they always work with a sort of black box approach. So you don't really understand how they analyze data. You only get the result. So this is an example that you can probably do two runs, two evaluations. In one time, holidays are flagged only during where the holidays is actually affecting traffic. And and Sundays are not flagged as holidays because that's normal behavior. And maybe you do another run where you also put the holiday as a flag, the Sundays as an holiday. And maybe you get different results and one is better than the other. It's impossible to know that in advance. You should play with the algorithms and find which is better depending on your implementation. What else is affecting a lot traffic that is not in the information that a camera can give you maybe very easily? Weather. So you want to have the weather. And the weather, how do you measure weather? You can't just give a link to an application. You probably need to know if it's raining or not. Usually when you open the window in the morning and it's raining, you know that it's a bad day. So probably you want the rain in millimeters. You have to choose a way to measure. And what else? Maybe also the temperature, because if it's very cold, people that say, okay, I don't want my little children to go to school with public transportation, I will bring them with my 200-horse car. So this is an example of how you have to take that. And weather is also interesting, because weather, you know that for the past, but you don't know that for the future. So if you start to use variables like weather, it means that if I want to do a prediction for next week, I first have to call some weather forecasting service, get the forecast for the weather, and then with this result, I can fulfill my data to make a real-time prediction and say, okay, according on this weather forecast and my model, the traffic next week on Tuesday at 5 p.m. in this crossing will be high, low, I don't know. So you are tying your model to another model. Another example, a lot of companies, they say they use machine learning a lot. And Netflix, that is one of our customers, they say that 75% of movies, they are watched via recommendations. So people is not going to choose a movie, but they see what is recommended to them. By the way, this is also a bias effect, because there are statistics that show that, I don't know if you ever saw the console from Netflix, but you have a list of movies with the picture of the movie on the same line. And most of the people, they choose just the first. So how you present data is affecting how people is consuming data. So you have to be careful with the bias effect, because you can bias users to use the data that you provide. But there is another interesting story from Netflix that I like to show, because they have this very powerful recommendation service, and one day, I think you all know this movie. There's no need for me to describe it. One of the masterpieces of the century is the mega shark versus the giant octopus. And one time they started to suggest this movie to people watching Woody Allen, Orson Welles, very serious movies. And they didn't understand what was happening. And what was happening was this. This is the scene from the movie. I removed the audio because it's too much. So what happened is that this scene went viral. People were sending links, and they were watching this few seconds, maybe a couple of minutes out of Netflix. And this was completely screwing up all the data that they were giving in input to their machine learning algorithm. So be careful. And so they changed the algorithm to understand this kind of pattern and avoid this. So providing and cleaning the data is very important. This is another interesting story from the Second World War. Abraham Wald is a mathematician. Was a mathematician, and what happened is that during the Second World War, a lot of planes, when they were sent into battle, they were shut down by the enemy. So they wanted to improve this. So they called a lot of scientists, they start to look where these planes were hit. And they say, we want to make the part where that are important for a plane more robust, adding maybe more iron, more structure, but this was also adding weight to the planes, and they cannot make more weight, because otherwise the planes, they are slower, with less weapons, so they have to find the right spot where to put some more protection. And all these people were looking at the point where the planes were hit and say, oh, probably here the wings is very important to cover them, maybe this part here. And Abraham Wald says, no, it's not the data that we see that is important, but it's the data that we don't see, because it's the planes that don't come back that are the planes that we want to protect, not the planes that come back. So probably it's exactly where these planes are not hit that we must put more protection. So on the cockpit, and probably this part of the wings is the more delicate one. So sometimes when you build a machine learning, think not only of the data that you see, but also of the data that you don't see. As I said, the cost, just to close up, so we have, using the machine learning cost, 0.42 instance hour when you build the model. So as I said, the model here, it took 15 minutes, so 42 cents. So you can build a model for less than 50 cents. And then you pay 10 cents for 1,000 prediction. Either you do them batch or you do them real time. There is a very small fee if you do real time, but it's really small, and maybe we can discuss. So you can experiment with machine learning, spending probably less than $1. And what I suggest is don't spend time. So if you are building a machine learning company, of course, you don't use this service, build your own algorithm. But if you have another application in mind, and machine learning can be helpful, you can just plug in this and maybe think afterwards of what to do. Because for a very large enterprise and small startups, money is a renewable resource. You can always get more money, but you need to show that the idea is good. So time is not renewable. So you don't spend the time where you can find something that you can plug in, maybe invest time afterwards. So thank you.
So we have time for a few questions.
Okay. Okay.
Does it somehow realize the curve, for example, if the data are evolving exponentially or regressing exponentially, not in linear fashion?
So the curve that we saw was the curve of predictions. So the model will understand the behavior of the data. The system can understand that. And I, of course, show you the default behavior. At the end, you can also see how the model is trying to analyze the data, so you get some information of what is automatically done, and you can tailor that. So you can, the idea is start with the default and see what is the result that you get, because we will adapt. If you see that the algorithm is not working, so the area under the curve is close to 50% chance, for example, for a binary classification, then you can look at the model, and you can, for example, change the way data is interpreted. You can also feed text to the model. I didn't do that, but if you have tweets, you can send free text. And then there is all the way you can package the text. Usually use structure like bag of words or n-grams to extract information from the text. And you can do that in the customization of the algorithm. So start with the default and then adjust. But the idea here is that it will adjust to normal behavior of data. So exponential data is managed automatically.
So it means you can get the weight of each variable involved in the prediction model, right?
You can get, sorry?
The weight.
The weight, yeah, so I didn't show all the features. But for example, if I go back here on the console, not on the model, but on the data sources. Let's use the bank example. So this is the data that we gave. And then here you can see the distribution of data. And you can see, for example, for binary values, how it's distributed. And here you get, but you get how much the data is used by the classification. So let's go, okay, here. So here you get, this is for variables, the correlation to target. So this tells you how much this variable, this is before building the model. So just looking at the data, how much this data is correlated to the target. For example, here you see that housing of the guy is probably not affecting at all, it's a very small number, while the way the contact, so the way you interact by phone, by mobile, by email, is more important. So you learn from the data.
Does this have an API as well? So can we get this information through the API?
I have to check. Usually, I would say yes, because everything that we do, but I don't remember the API for this, so I will look and give you
the answer. What about that data cleaning? Does it perform any kind of cleaning outliers?
So we already noticed missing values and some wrong data, but error, you should clean the data before. So usually the workflow is aggregate data, clean the data, and enrich the data with information like the day of the week, the weather, and then use it here. We manage missing values, this kind of information, but the more you do in advance, the better it is.
One more.
How much of the data pre-processing you can do within the tool, and how much you have to do outside?
The tool is not allowing you to do a lot, if not to manage missing values. So you should do that in advance. So S3 is an object storage you put and get data. So you can use your own cleaning, or you can use other services we already provide to do that. But it's just a CSV output, so you can use whatever tool you want, even Excel for small data sets. So I'm available here, and if you have any question, Danilo P is my Twitter handle, and it's also my email at amazon.com. So please ask me any questions.